बिस्मिल्लाह रहमान रहीम। टुडे इज़ माय टॉपिक इज़ मैक्सिलरी एक्सपेंशन द कन्वेंशनल मेथड, द सारपी एंड द मारपी, डेट इज़ द सर्जिकल असिस्टेड रैपिड पैलेटल एक्सपेंशन एंड द मिनी इम्प्लांट असिस्टेड रैपिड पैलेटल एक्सपेंशन। द ट्रांसवर्स डायमेंशन ऑफ द मैक्सिला कैन बी इंक्रीज इन फाइव वेज। नंबर वन, द ऑर्थोडोंटिकली थ्रू डेंटल टिपिंग। नंबर टू, बाय रैपिड पैलेटल एक्सपेंशन बाय ऑर्थोडोंटिक्स इन ग्रोइंग पेशेंट्स। नंबर थ्री, थ्रू सर्जिकली असिस्टेड ऑर्थोडोंटिक पैलेटल एक्सपेंशन नॉन ग्रोइंग पेशेंट्स। नंबर फोर, थ्रू सर्जिकल एक्सपेंशन बाय मीन्स ऑफ सेगमेंटल सर्जरी। एंड नंबर फाइव, बाय मिनी इम्प्लांट असिस्टेड रैपिड पैलेटल एक्सपेंशन। व्हेन प्लानिंग फॉर द करेक्शन ऑफ द ट्रांसवर्स मैक्सिलरी डेफिशिएंसी अक्रॉस वाइड, द स्ट्रेंथ्स एंड वीकनेसेस ऑफ ईच एप्लीकेबल ऑप्शन शुड बी अंडरस्टूड एंड कंसीडर्ड। मैक्सिलरी ट्रांसवर्स डेफिशिएंसी यूजुअली रिजल्ट्स इन पोस्टीरियर क्रॉस वाइड्स and has an incidence among the general population of approximately 9.4%. Because the relative transverse dimension between the maxilla and mandible is also influenced by the anterior-posterior relationship, Jacobs and colleagues divided transverse discrepancies in 1980 into relative or absolute posterior crossbites. And how these can be evaluated? The determination is made when the dental model of a patient is handheld in central lesion and posterior crossbite is evident. The models and then are then moved to position the dental arches into a class 1 canine relationship. If the crossbite is corrected with the anteroposterior alignment of the arches, it is considered a relative transverse discrepancies. If the crossbite still exists following the movement, it is considered an absolute transverse discrepancy. An absolute posterior crossbite may occur bilaterally or unilaterally and is often associated with a class 2 anterior open bite dentofacial deformity. However, absolute crossbite may also occur in class 1 and class 3 malocclusions. The etiology of posterior crossbite may be congenital, traumatic, iatrogenic or developmental. The restricted transverse growth caused by surgical interventions in patients with cleft lip and palate is an example of iatrogenic origin, whereas long-term thumb sucking is a good example of developmental etiology. The typical clinical findings in a patient with a posterior crossbite are a narrow maxillary dental arch, often with an hourglass-shaped arch form, a high palatal vault, dental crowding, often with palatally inclined posterior teeth, an anterior open bite, and a class 2 malocclusion. A dental crossbite involving only one or two teeth should be treated orthodontically. However, a crossbite involving more than two teeth is likely skeletal in nature, and a surgical orthodontic approach should be considered. Now comes to the first method, that is the orthodontic expansion. This treatment usually involves dental tipping and is indicated when the skeletal base width is adequate. The required transverse arch dimension can be achieved by moving the teeth buccally using orthodontic forces. However, stability is doubtful after orthodontic tipping of the posterior teeth beyond their bony base. Dental tipping leads to hanging of the palatal cusp of the posterior teeth below the occlusal plane and will complicate subsequent surgical expansion. The increased angulation of the molars will require additional surgical expansion of the palate. This action will not only jeopardize the skeletal stability but will also build orthodontic dental relapse into the surgical result. Now comes the second option, that is the rapid palatal expansion. Growth of the maxilla takes place at the suture margins by deposition of new bone from the adjacent cellular layer. The principle of orthopedic expansion of the palate relies on the physiology of normal active growth and elasticity of the new bone at the suture lines. Cellular activity at the suture lines decreases with age, and a wide age range between 16 and 35 years before completion of the synostosis has been reported. However, it is generally accepted that rapid palatal expansion without surgical assistance is clinically successful only until the age of 14 to 16 years. As much as 30% to 50% of the gain in the transverse dimension with this method can be lost as a result of relapse, which proves that most of the width is obtained by dental tipping and not skeletal expansion. Orthopedic expansion of the maxilla beyond the age of 16 years has certain disadvantages, including severe pain, pressure necrosis of the palatal soft tissue, dental tipping with no skeletal change, and uncontrolled relapse. Surgically assisted rapid palatal expansion. This is the third option. This treatment option should be considered in the following situation. Number one, for the creation of arch length in patient with severe crowding and when extractions, for example, premolars already removed or not an option. Number two, for patients in whom unilateral maxillary expansion is required. Number three, where maxillary expansion is the only surgically indicated. And number four, for any patient in whom orthodontic expansion has failed and suture resistance must be overcome. The surgical technique involves bilateral osteotomies of the lateral walls of the maxilla carried out from the piriform apertures past the zygomatic buttress. The pterygomaxillary junctures are separated and the palatal osteotomy is carried forward from the posterior nasal spine to just posterior to the incisive canal. Two paramedian osteotomies may be performed in patients who require large expansion. This design also prevents unfavorable nasal septum deviation. The distractor may be tooth bone or bone, and the device should remain in place for at least 8 to 10 weeks following completion of distraction. Relapse occurs following distraction with both appliances. However, the bone appliances prove to be more stable. Now comes the fourth option, that is the surgical expansion. Surgical expansion can be accomplished by either posterior segmental osteotomies or a Lefort 1 osteotomy. Segmenting the maxilla in the down fractured position when a large amount of expansion is required. Bilateral palatal osteotomies should be performed. The osteotomy should be made just lateral to the nasal septum where the palatal bone is thin and the mucosa thick. Soft tissue release may be helpful for large expansion and should be performed off the osteotomy line. Care should also be taken to ensure that the nasal mucosa is intact when performing soft tissue release. Perforation of the nasal mucosa as well as the palatal mucosa may result in the development of an oronasal fistula. Grafting and appropriate rigid fixation should be used in palatal expansion of more than 3 mm. Post-surgical orthodontic control of the expanded segments is paramount for optimal post-surgical stability. A higher rate of side effects such as reduction in alveolar bone thickness and height, bone dehiscence and gingival recession may be expected as a result of important mechanical forces delivered at the teeth and its supporting structures. Therefore, surgical assisted rapid palatal expansion is often indicated to these patients. This procedure increases expansion predictability and success and reduces side effects. One of the available SRP techniques consists of a Lefort 1 osteotomy associated with surgical rupture of the mid-palatal suture, which decreases the mechanical resistance to the lateral forces that will be applied by Hyrax expanders, usually anchored to the first molars and first premolars. However, despite its benefits, SRP increases biological and financial cost of the treatment. The surgery requires hospitalization and general anesthesia, which might scare patients away from surgical orthodontic treatment for good. In face of that, some authors have investigated the use of orthodontic mini implants as auxiliary encouraged devices to optimize the application of mechanical forces to circummaxillary sutures, thus avoiding the otherwise indispensable osteotomies. This system, which has been called the micro implant assisted rapid palatal expansion, that is MARPI, applies forces to the mini micro implants and not to the teeth or periodontium. Different appliance designs and techniques have been described in the literature, and each leads to specific associated outcomes. A recent clinical study using one of them found an 86.96% success rate in young adult patients with stable results after 30 months of follow-up. Bone palatal expanders have been shown to be a viable treatment option to correct a transverse maxillary deficiency in adults in several case reports showing evidence of clinical success. Since bone expanders rely on skeletal anchorage obtained by mini implants, applying force directly to the basal bone mini implant stability is integral to successful skeletal orthopedic expansion. The selected expander should be the one with the greatest expansion capacity that at the same time may be kept at an ideal vertical distance from the palatal mucosa. Bicortical encouraged oral and nasal is determinant of success, and if the expander is too distant from the mucosa, more than 2 mm, microimplants may not reach the nasal cortical bone. Moreover, chances of MI deformation are higher if the force is applied too far from the implant bone interface. The body of the expander should be placed as posterior as possible, close to the junction of hard and soft palate. Hard palate mucosa is vital. The greatest resistance against suture opening is located in the sutures between maxilla and pterygoid plates, and forces should be applied more posteriorly to overcome initial resistance and promote parallel opening of the mid-palatal suture. When forces are applied directly into the center of resistance of the maxilla by means of MI and not to the teeth, as in conventional expansion, the force system is more favorable due to a homogeneous force dissipation, which prevents buccal tipping and produces a more parallel suture opening. How does it activate? Activation should be 4 turns for the first 3 days, then 2, sometimes 0.25 mm to 0.5 mm per day. Remember that 0.25 mm is equal to 1 turn. Depending upon patient's pain response, it can be adjusted. The 8 mm MSE has 40 activations, that is 0.25 mm per turn, the 10 mm 150 activations, and the 12 mm the 60 activation, that is the midline screw. Activation should not reach the limit because the expander loses rigidity as it approaches the limit and might undergo some deformation. MARPI has gained increasing popularity as an alternative to the more invasive SARPI. Overloading of the peri-implant bone can lead to loss of primary stability of orthodontic mini-implants. In addition, there is a decreased risk of mini-implant loosening if the stress in the cervical region of the peri-implant bone region is low. Mini-implant deformation and fracture in bone-bone expansion are more likely to occur with monocortical anchorage rather than bicortical anchorage, and that the depth of the bicortical anchorage has little impact on mini-implant deformation and fracture. Bicortical mini-implant anchorage has been demonstrated to be superior compared with monocortical mini-implant anchorage for orthodontic tooth movement. Bone-bone expansion bicortical anchorage is more favorable than monocortical anchorage, and at the depth of bicortical anchorage has a minimal impact on stability. In addition, this finding also supported by Wolf's law. The monocortical model had an increased maximum principal stress value compared with the bicortical models. A high principal stress value, as in the monocortical model, may place the bone remodeling in the pathologic overload window, in which stress fractures and bone resorption not coupled to the formation occur, leading to overloaded implants and implant loosening. A greater magnitude of the force experienced by mini implants increases the likelihood of deformation and mini implant fracture. It is found that monocortical mini implants experience significantly greater stress at the bone implant interface, specifically around the initial cortical bone layer, compared with bicortical mini implants. Bicortical mini implants encourage result in improved mini implant stability, decreased mini implant deformation and fracture, more parallel expansion in the coronal plane, and increased expansion in bone-bone palatal expansion. The depth of the bicortical mini implant anchorage has little impact on mini implant stability, deformation, and transverse displacement in bone-bone palatal expansion. Careful about the minimally invasive 2-point retention should be supported by the guidance through the sectional wires in the incisor region. This gives the appliance sufficient stability and prevents asymmetric movement of the right and left maxilla. Direct force application to the bone results in good skeletal effectiveness, and relapses are prevented by the implant-supported transpalatal bar. In MARPI, there is more skeletal expansion as compared to the conventional expansion, at least in the initial phases. Place the expander closer to the palate depth to get maximum skeletal expansion, and many a times due to anatomical limitation, it may need more than one expander to get the required expansion. While placing the second expander, activate it 1.5 mm and then do the wire bending and soldering. If you remove one expander and place other expander in the span of 1 hour, there is always a relapse of 1 to 1.5 mm, and this must be accommodated in the new expander. In conventional palatal expansion, forces are applied to the teeth below the center of resistance of the maxilla. This system forces generates buccal dentoalveolar tipping and an inverted V opening, that is coronal view, indicated by the red dotted lines. The amount of momentum generated is directly associated with palatal depth. In MARP, forces are applied directly into the maxillary center of resistance by means of the MI, which practically eliminates inclination forces of posterior teeth and promotes more parallel suture opening. MI should be placed carefully, although the guides, that is expander holes facilitates its placement. MI should be as perpendicular as possible to the palatal bone, each MI parallel to all others, so that the force distribution is effective. Therefore, both the anteroposterior and the lateral inclination should be repeatedly checked during placement. When placing the posterior MI, patient should keep the mouth wide open to avoid changing their anteroposterior inclination. MI tend to distal tipping. MI can be delivered in most patients without previous bone perforation using the digital key. If torque is excessively high, bone perforation can be made using a 1 mm diameter drill. A very high arched and deep palate, typical of chronic mouth breathers, may hinder the vertical positioning of the MSE. For these patients, the anterior or posterior segments of the expander can be trimmed so that the expander can be placed closer to the mucosa. This option is acceptable because forces are applied to the MI, leaving to teeth only a supporting purpose during MI placement. Occlusal radiographs or CBCT should be requested to confirm MARPI success defined by mid-parallel suture opening, because not all cases display an inter-incisal diastema. However, if the diastema is created, as in some cases, suture split and skeletal expansion of the maxilla are evident. It remains unclear why few MARPI cases fail. But it is believed that differences in calcification patterns of the mid-palatal suture and craniofacial architecture, that is higher resistance, are contributing factors. As mechanical forces are distributed into the palate by the MIs, the stress on teeth and supporting structures understated, which might induce side effects such as gingival recession and buccal bone dehiscence. No severe complication of MARPI have been reported in the literature. The most frequent complication is the inflammation and hyperplasia of the mucosa around the MI, usually associated with inadequate local hygiene. A significant amount of time should be spent to orientate the patient about hygiene importance, usually using all the tools to optimize it, dental brush and water jet. In cases where mechanical control is not sufficient, a chemical method can be temporarily employed, usually chlorhexidine, rinse or gel. If inflammation affects only one MI, it should be removed and the retreatment may progress normally. Hyperplasia may also occur when there is not enough distance from the expander and or its wires to the mucosa, usually associated with local pain. In patients with slow bone remodeling, such as those with type 2 diabetes, additional care should be taken to avoid buccosynovial communication after MI removal, as bone neoformation takes longer. Other systemic conditions should be carefully assessed and might contraindicate the therapy. One of the limitations of this technique is associated with very narrow and high arched palates, which hinders MSC vertical positioning and reduces the success rate of treatment. Thanks.